好，各位伙伴们，因为时间关系呢，如果您找位置，就可以好好的坐下。然后，因为刚上一个议程刚结束，所以有人会陆陆续续进来，那我们就会慢慢的开始。好，那很开心大家今天可以一起坐在这边，然后来听来自台湾跟德国还有日本的经验。那我们今天主要是要聊的议程是新世代数位公民，我们怎么样透过公民科技专案去塑造他们的未来。 OK， 好，那首先呢，我先介绍一下今天的 speakers， 今天的讲者。好，首先我是今天主持人，我也是今天的分享者，我是 Tiff， 然后我在 G0V 临时小学校担任专案经理，然后我是一个 AKA 狗派，这是我的狗狗，然后再来是那个松雅，她是来自德国的讲者，对，然后还有跟大家挥挥手，然后她是一个猫派，这两只是她养的猫咪，然后再来是 Saya， 她是来自日本的讲者，然后这两只是她的狗狗，然后我们今天不是要来跟大家宣导那个猫猫狗狗的那个教义啊什么的，我们今天好好聊一下，我们怎么样从数位公民的一个视角，然后去推动让更多青年加入公民科技。好，那因为今天的议程会夹杂中文跟英文，所以建议大家，如果你有戴耳机，你可以扫一下这个 QR code， 进入到 YouTube 之后呢，你就可以听翻译。OK， 好，这个好。OK， 好。So, we will have Chinese and English language in our session. So please scan the QR code and go into the YouTube, and you can wear your earphones to listen the the good translation from interpreters. Okay. Okay. How? Oh, okay. Wait a minute.Okay, okay, next. 我们今天的那个 Q&A 会以 Slido 的方式进行，然后如果等一下你错过这一页，我们在官网跟你的 OPAS 上面也都还有。那另外是，就是我们很希望可以邀请大家一起帮忙共笔，把你听到的内容记下来，然后让更多没有办法参与的人可以来透过共笔了解这一场的内容。好，那另外帮 G0V 撒蜜宣传一下 On Conference 目前热烈的征稿跟投票中，那如果你想参加的话呢，可以到报道处，那记得他在明天早上十点就截止了。 OK， 好，那在今天的那个议程中，我们想要特别感谢我们这一次议程的合作伙伴，给了我们非常多的支持，是 FNF Global Innovation Hub。 那等一下时间我们会邀请那个 FNF，然后上来跟我们简单介绍一下 FNF 他们怎么样透过不同的方式去推动民主的。OK， 好，那我们欢迎 Celine。
Hi， 大家好。Yeah, thank you for giving me 5 minutes to quickly introduce what we are doing as the FNF Global Innovation Hub. Yes.So we are from the Friedrich Naumann Foundation. We are a liberal foundation based in Germany. So what does it mean to be a liberal foundation? That means that everything that we do and we work on is based on liberal values. So for example, democracy, human rights, and freedom of expression. We have our office in Taipei is called the Global Innovation Hub. So we are, so to say, the think and do tank working on innovation and societal questions here in Taiwan. And we have a small team of 6 people in Taiwan and 1 colleague in Germany. And we also have great partners. I don't think I have to introduce them to you at this event. We also work with People Power Together and a lot of great experts who work with us on think tank questions.And then we have 2 programmatic pillars at our foundation that we work on. One of them is Innovation for Democracy, where we look at how innovation can help foster democracy. This program is headed by Yao Wei, who is not, she's there. So if you have any questions about this later, she can help you answer those questions. So just to show you what we do, for example, we developed the Open Starter Game. This is aI think I mentioned this in this event because it has a lot to do with what will be talked about later. So this game introduces to the players how to start your own civic tech and open source project. And then we also have a digital participation online training. We have an Innovation for Democracy Cafe, also hosted by Awei. It's a show, reoccurring show, talking about innovative projects and how they help democracy with the experts. And then we also have a study on public money, public code, for governments, how to work with the civic tech community. Then we have another programmatic pillar, that's digital transformation. There we look more how emerging technologies affect society. And here we work more topics like the censorship in China, content moderation studies from all around the world, AI front lines in the China's PLA and NATO, for example. And then we also bring together stakeholders from, for example, the Estonian members of parliament with the Ministry of Digital Affairs in Taiwan to help them have an exchange on cybersecurity, for example. Yes, yeah, so if you have any questions, let us know. We also have Judy here, another colleague of us. So yeah, we are happy to help with questions. And without further ado, I'm very much looking forward to the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Celine, for all the supports. 好，等一下哦。OK， 好，那等一下的那个分享啊，我们会先从台湾的经验开始，然后再换德国经验，然后最后换日本，然后我们最后会有一个就是算三国的对谈，然后如果你有任何的问题，可以边在听的时候就在 Slido 先打下来。OK， 好。那我就先开始分享，我是 Tiff， 然后我是临时小学校的专案经理。那今天主要是想来分享我们怎么样从台湾的公民科技社群 G0V 去发起一个数位公民的专案。好，那很多人啊在听到临时小学校的时候，第一会问我说，哈，它是一个很多可以吃的零食的学校吗？或是问我说，这是小学生要念的吗？还是有人问过我说，你们什么时候开学？他们以为是真的一间学校。但是其实临时小学校呢，它就是一个比较像，你可以把它想象是跳脱学校的一个数位公民的学习网络。好，那在这个网络里面呢，学生会怎么开始学习？我们这边以临时小学校比较常见的国高中生跟大学生这群学生他们的学习路径来分享。首先呢，他们在学习的阶段，第一个阶段的时候呢，他们大概会有两个节点，一个是他们会透过网络嘛，因为现在学生都是数位原生世代，他们会透过网络找到很多不同的学习资源。然后再来第二个，他们几乎以台湾学生来讲，很多的时间都在学校，所以他们会透过学校的课程或是老师告诉他的活动资讯得到这些讯息，然后他们会进行学习。那在这个阶段，临时小学校给他们什么样的资源？我们有线上的数位公民开放课程，我们有举办各式的实体工作坊跟营队，另外我们有举办专案孵化竞赛，让学生他在这个阶段他可以选择适合他的方式进行学习。那另外在学校端的话呢，我们有跟学校合作去举办像一学期或是半学期甚至是一天的数位公民专案实作课。好，那学生在学习概念、心法、经验、技术，开始对 G0V 对公民科技有一些理解之后呢，他如果想要继续，他可以开始走进 G0V 的社群。那 G0V 社群呢，就是对我们来讲，他就进入到另一个阶段，就是他可以接触真实的社会。那在社群里面，他透过参加黑客松，然后或是在 Slack 协作平台，然后以及各个专案 G0V 很多专案都有自己的小聚，以及他甚至又可以在这个阶段才参加专案孵化竞赛。透过这些方式，他可以认识到各个领域不同的社会人士、专家学者，然后他也可以开始更深入去了解台湾社会或是国际到底有哪一些议题目前正在发生。那在这里，在这个公民科技社群，大家用了什么样的方式、数位的方式来解？那另外，他也可以在这边学到更多数位的解方，然后包含像技术或是策略的思维。OK， 那在接触之后呢，有一些学生他就会选择做专案或参与专案。那在这个阶段，我们就是期待说他可以开始学以致用，然后透过应用跟实作，然后把他所学 真正去解决一个社会问题。好，那在这样整个历程之后呢，我们最后就会希望可以邀请他把他的经验也开源，然后不论是成为下一个参与 Juling V 的新参者的引路人，或是他可以来我们的数位公民课程里面开课，然后或是当我们某一场演讲的讲者，都会对于就是数位公民的推广有更多的贡献。好，所以这个是在我们这个数位公民学习网络学生他会走的一个路径。好，那说了这么多，大家可能会好奇说，到底为什么 Juling V 要做这件事情，它意义在哪里？首先从社群视角的话，大家应该多少都可以感觉到，很多不同的组织它如果已经发展了十多年，他们其实需要更多的青年心血来加入，然后甚至去把更多的经验去传承。然后另一个就是，当你需要更多的青年加入的时候，它其实需要更简单的好上手的指南，让它更容易参与。不然其实我相信在座大家都曾经是那个刚进来的青年，可能会有一些茫然。那当你要有这个指南之后，其实你需要后面有人把 Juling V 社群的经验做转换。那在教育视角的话，因为我以前是一个实验教育的工作者，我在学校待了四年，那我们在现场其实很常看到不论是老师、学生或家长，他们对于像现在 AI 冲击或是科技的快速变化，他们非常的茫然。然后那因应这个茫然，政府虽然有给了一些指引，大家应该多少可能看过他们有写什么媒体素养的白皮书啊，或是数位教育要怎么做，但是其实目前这些素养的定义还不是那么清楚。然后另外还有一些问题是，大家会分科，资讯的放资讯，然后媒体素养它可能就放公民，但是其实有很多它是通则的概念，可以应用在不同的领域。所以我们很希望可以帮忙一起来想想这个通则是什么。然后另外一个就是，这些通则之下的具体做法目前也还没有太多人给予一些指引。好，那我们在这两个发现之下，我们看到了一个机会，就是在2020年疫情的时候，大家开始不得不面对数位学习这件事情，所以老师学生开始去碰，然后现在开始熟悉。那另外一个就是，台湾现在的课纲是108课纲，它其实非常重视自发互动共好的精神，然后希望孩子的学习可以跟真实情境连接，然后也重视应用，也重视科技教育。但是在这些机会下，我们就在想，好，那 Juling V 的精神就是，与其抱怨，不如做一些行动。所以我们就在想，那 Juling V 可以做什么呢？好，那为什么 Juling V 可以做什么？因为 Juling V 已经，这边不知道大家是不是都已经认识 Juling V。 Juling V 从2012年开始，我们每两个月办黑客松，然后在这边聚集了13000名的数位公民，然后提了1000多个以上的提案。所以我们认为说，在 Juling V 社群，它有来自不同领域的专家学者，而且这些专家学者他是真正透过专案去实践，他有很多的经验可以成为孩子在不同专案或是不同领域的引路人。 OK， 然后另外一个就是 Juling V， 其实在10年以来，它已经形成了一种，我可以说它是一种专案学习的模式。它透过找一群人，然后来协作，然后一起去运用数位科技去解一个公共议题。那我们就在想，好，我们如果已经有这样的明确的精神跟模式的话，那就是一个很好的时机，我们可以放在教育现场了。好，所以总结以上就是，第一是 Juling V 的社群有足够多的不同专业的人士，然后再来是我们已经有明确的模式可以去推广给教育现场的不论青师生。那另外一个就是，我们也发现如果大家对数位公民的想象还是模糊的话，我们认为也许 Juling V 可以是成为一个数位公民理想图像之一。那我们也许就从 Juling V 社群开始来想怎么样去推动数位公民教育。好，然后我们那时候就在想说，好，如果我们要在 Juling V 社群推动一个 for 青年的就是数位公民教育，我们需不需要再创一个新的公民科技社群？那在我们四年以来经验，跟我们曾经在 FTO 就是一个 Facing the Ocean， 是一个亚洲区的国际黑客松，我们访谈了学生，然后台日韩学生跟我们一致都有发现一个，就是其实不需要创造新的，我们只需要把原本的公民科技社群去降低他参与的门槛，这样子学生就可以参与。而且学生会认为说，你降低了，我才可以有机会去认识更多各行各业的社会人士，才有更多跨领域跨年龄的协作可能性。好，那 我们怎么样降低这个门槛？首先就是临时小学校的角色很像一个桥梁，然后我们帮忙转译跟连结居邻 V 社群的经验，然后或是我们会跟不同的单位合作，然后也会跟老师合作，然后把他们的经验转换成线上或实体的数位公民课程，然后我们跟学校合作，我们办专案孵化竞赛，然后我们也跟各个不同的单位连结，然后举办师培。那我们对象是谁？我们目前的对象主要是国高中生跟大学生，然后还有教育工作者。另外在社会的话也蛮多社会人士参与，包含像一直想要做一些社会改革的伙伴，然后以及他想要做进修的人。 OK， 那小学校目前我们专注在的数位公民素养是放在我们希望可以培养大家自主协作跨界行动的专案协作的一个能力。那在这样的培育下，他可以学到什么？我们主要 focus 的是什么？在这样历程里面，他会得到问题解决的一个能力，然后另一个是他会开始学习怎么样人机协作，因为在这个时代其实你很难不人机协作。然后再来就是他知道怎么样跟不同领域的人一起协作去解决一个问题。然后再来一个是我们希望他可以开始做公共参与，不论他几岁。好，那这边细讲一下，我们在这四个行动里面，我们具体做了什么？我们现在开了70堂以上的线上公民课程，然后这些课程都是来自于居邻 V 社群的参与者。那我们开了哪些课？一个是就是我们最重要的，我们希望鼓励大家做专案，所以我们会分享专案的协作的心法，然后以及你如何跟大家协作，有没有一些好的工具可以用，然后再来就是专案它有没有一些阶段性的就是指引，我们可以跟大家分享，让大家更好的有一个专案的进程。然后另外一个是你做专案你需要人机协作，你需要有一些技术，所以我们有一些技术的课程。 OK， 那另外一个是我们其实在这两年也发现说我们不能再只做专案了，就是需要再更多一些新的资讯，包含像科技或社会趋势。然后这些东西不只是学生需要，其实居邻 V 长期的贡献者他们也都会来上这些课，来听听目前的趋势有哪些，像 AI Web3。 然后另外一个就是居邻 V 是一个开源社群，所以开源的概念也我们也认为对学生非常重要。那后面两个是我们近期发现，就是很多学生他可能跟我说我其实不太知道我在公民科技社群可以获得些什么，然后对我职涯有没有帮助，所以我们也邀请了居邻 V 社群的贡献者来分享他们职涯的故事，跟公民科技社群如果再往下走有没有可能走成一个职业。然后另外我们也会邀请老师跟学生来分享他们实际在居邻 V 参与专案他们经验是什么，以及学校老师他怎么样去实践。好，那第二个就是我们刚刚讲的，我们有跟各个学校合作课程，我们主要是邀请学校老师一起来跟我们筹划，然后在这筹划过程中其实就是一种师培。我们不会特别还要先师培老师然后才愿意跟老师合作，我们在这过程中我们会有很多的对话。那另外就是我们也会邀请社群的参与者一起来担任讲师，然后还有担任叫临时先辈，不是那个吃的先辈，他就是我们邀请居邻 V 长期贡献者然后来当专案的 mentor 这样。那我这边举一个例子，是我们曾经跟台中女中合作过两学期的18周课程。然后当时就是我们前面大概就是会先介绍一下居邻 V， 然后接着我们会选定一个主题，用主题切入。那我们那时候选的是媒体试读，我们就邀请了 IORG 然后还有就是居邻 V 专案 COFAX 来分享他们面对一个假讯息的议题，他们用了什么样的解方，那公民可以用什么身份参与。因为像 IORG 它是一个公司，然后真的假的他们现在已经成立协会了，那当时只是一开始只是居邻 V 的专案。那在他们分享完之后，我们就会开始说，如果你也想要就是做一个公民科技专案像 COFAX 一样可以怎么做，所以我们就会进去一个步骤一个步骤引导他们。那在这过程中也会有刚刚说的临时先辈可以给专案咨询，然后最后他们就会分享他们专案成果。对，大概的我们课程的循环是这样子的。那有一些学生就会开始在课程结束之后慢慢走到黑客松，或是来参加我们的专案孵化竞赛，有更多的延伸学习。 好，那再来一个，就是我们每年都会办专案孵化的竞赛。因为刚刚前面你会看到我们开了好多的课，大家学了好多，但是如果真的有学生他想要做专案，有没有办法获得更好的支持，那他可以我们就会推荐他来专案孵化竞赛。那专案孵化竞赛我们其实是以陪伴取代比较跟竞争，但因为为了好理解，我们还是放了竞赛这两个词。所以一开始的话，就是我们会邀在我们的小学校官网，然后邀请大家来就是提案，然后我们之后会进行第一个初选。那初选过后呢，他就可以开始，我们会提供就是他可以跟 G0V 社群的大大们有一个咨询的机会，然后再来就会进入到决选。那在这过程中，他除了可以获得先辈们的咨询之外，他也可以获得一些奖金。因为大家知道一个专案要延续，奖金其实也还蛮重要，因为他可能要一些场地费或是设备的费用。然后最后呢，我们都会鼓励他们把专案开源。那如果大家对就是专案孵化竞赛的那个过往的提案有兴趣，都可以直接 Google 林芝小学校，然后我们在官网上面都有记录每一个专案。好，那最后一个是我们这四年来一直在尝试跟不同的领域、不同的社群合作，包含我们一直在跟老师合开师培的课程，因为我们相信不是每个老师或是每个学校都有余裕让我们有空间进到那个学校开课，但如果老师想要自己在课堂上放一点数位公民的概念或是方法的话，我们也许可以透过师培来教他们。OK， 然后另外一个就是我们都会一起，就每年，因为我们小学校的专案是源自于 G0V 揪松团，所以我们会定期办黑客松跟社群聚会，让大家可以参与。然后再来就是我们会长期跟不同的社群连结，像这个是那个 Coffer Japan， 他们今年年初的时候来参加我们今年专案孵化竞赛的决选这样子。然后大家透过分享，让更多对公民科技有兴趣的学生可以交流。好，那在这四年来，我们大概有2500位以上的参与者。那其中我们也发现，国高中生跟教师的人数是逐年上升的。那另外一个就是，我们也很惊艳的是，在这四年我们收到了127件的提案，其中有80件是国高中生跟大学生提出，而且获奖的团队也蛮多，都是学生专案。嗯，但当然这某部分也是因为我们在推广对象可能像是我们和学校合作，或是我们推广对象学生，所以学生的专案也有提升这样子。那到底大家在就是我们的小学校的所有的就是学习网络中，他们可以获得些什么？我们先说说学校的孩子们，他们得到了些什么。我们其实发现在这几年，国高中生、大学生，他们会自己透过网络去连接彼此，然后去线上协作，一起做专案。那而且很多其实不是都市的孩子，反而是乡村地区的孩子，然后这是让我们觉得很感动，也会希望可以继续推展的。那这些孩子他们会在就是不论是我们的课程营队或是竞赛中，第一是找到伙伴，第二是透过我们课程会教他们怎么做专案，他们会开始去厘清他们真正想做的是什么，然后以及我们会介绍不同的数位解方，他们就会得到一些新的方法。那另外一个就是大家都知道学生很忙，所以他们很喜欢利用我们竞赛的 deadline 作为他的就是这个时间一定要完成。那也因为有这个 deadline， 他们在这个时间点就会获得一个成就。那还有一个是因为他参加我们的课程跟竞赛，其实就会进入到 G0V 社群，所以很多学生他会觉得我在这边认识了很多更多业界人士，不是只有学校老师。 OK， 好，那再来一个就是教育工作者他在林芝小学校可以获得些什么。首先是跟我们一起合作的台中女中的淑妍老师，他其实一开始听到跟我们合作，他非常的害怕，他说我只是一个公民的老师，然后我没有任何的科技技术，你确定吗？然后我就跟他说不用担心，因为 G0V 社群其实有很多不同的技术人才，然后大家会提供很多的协助。那他在最后就是合作下，他就觉得真的他安心很多。那另外一个是因为一个老师他在学校领域其实很难接触到其他社会议题，除非他够积极，那他也因为这样合作去看到了更多不同的社会议题。 OK， 好，那另外一个很酷的老师，他是竹东高中的钟美老师， 他那时候就是自己在学校开了一个问题解决课，然后我那时候知道他好像对行人地狱有想要做一些专案，我就鼓励他说还是你来参加我们专案孵化竞赛，真的把它做出来。然后他就真的做出来，这个专案现在也还蛮有名，甚至有跟不同县市政府合作。那他在解决的就是行人地狱的问题，那他把他的经验把它转换成就是学校学生在就是像问题分析或解方时可以运用到，所以学生他有跟我说，他说学生听到他自己做专案而且还得奖之后就觉得，哦，原来老师自己真的做过，然后他们就更有动力，而且他会知道学生可能在问题解决觉得很困难的时候，他不会觉得，哦，这些人太笨了吧，因为他会知道我自己做过专案，问题解决是很困难的一件事情，他有更多的经验可以跟学生分享。好，那再来一个是社会设计者跟改革者可以在 Julian B 或者什么，然后这里有 TED， 就是像 TED 当时他是自己感觉到开放课程很分散，所以他就到 Julian B 提案，那在 Julian B 就获得很多不同领域的社会人士加入，然后之后他参加了专案孵化竞赛 OK， 然后最后他也成为我们开放课程的老师。那另外一个是小草书屋，他是一个做客服课后辅导，然后尤其是针对弱势孩子的一个单位。那时候他是想要做一件事情，就是他们很多的那个点数是纸本的，然后纸本常常会被弄丢，不然就是乱记，所以他们就说有没有可能有人来帮我们优化成一个 app。 就真的在我们的专案孵化竞赛找到了一位来自美国的工程师，然后他们就做了一个 app， 这个 app 现在甚至开始想要推广到不同的课后辅导的单位然后所以可以看到社会改革跟设计者他们可以在这边找到更多的伙伴。好，然后再来最后一个是我只是单纯想要进修，然后可以在 Julian B 或者什么。首先这是一个资讯工程师跟我们说的，他说他有上过我们的线上课，然后他上完之后才然后跑来黑客松，他发现到黑客松有更多应用的机会，然后也比较有成就感。那另一个是就是因为 我自己本身是导导阿学的那个发起人，然后我们的社群里面有一个参与者，他是就是之前是哈豪的动画师，他那时候想转职 UI UX 设计师，然后他就说他那时候就想说，一个是他本来对教育很有兴趣，另外一个是他如果可以把公民科技的经验放成他的履历会很有帮助，那他现在也真的很顺利的找到了工作。好，那在这边我想要我们想统整一下，就是因为今天想要聊的是青年到底在公民科技社群的状况是什么。我这边先依我们历年临时小学校看到的状况来跟大家分享，到底有哪一些青年会自主来提案。因为我们现在主推是学生，所以我们还是以我们目前收到的蛮多专案还是来自学生。那学生他们大多是谁？谁会来提？有一大部分是实验教育的学生。OK， 然后另一部分是很多刚起步的学生组织或社群的发起人，那另一个是我们发现还是有比较多科技技术背景的学生来参与，比起人文背景的多一些。然后另一个社会人士的话，一样刚刚说社会设计者蛮常会来参加的，会来提案，然后另一个也是刚起步的组织会过来。那再来就是大家解决问题的面向跟方法是什么，学生化学生的部分大家还是多数专注在他目前就是 daily life 他的困境，那包含像学习，因为他一天到晚都得泡在学校泡在补习班，所以他其实会看到很多学习的问题。然后这些学习问题蛮多是他们觉得资源太分散，然后所以他们想要做串联整合然后媒合，包含像是各种活动开放课程实验教育的资讯，然后或是学伴的媒合，因为他不想要只认识他的学校的同学，他想认识更多人，然后有包含像参考书的评价以及大学课程的评价。 OK， 好，那近几年我们有发现有一些学生开始会注意到时事议题，包含他们会希望可以以高中生视角获得更多全民国防的资讯，甚至他们希望可以开启更多的讨论。好，那社会人士大多都提什么？第一个急迫议题，像刚刚说的那个行人地狱的问题，然后再来是人文扎根，就是可能会有人提像是平林的文化的推广，然后再来弱势族群也蛮多人提的就是怎么样让弱势族群透过数位可以有更好的生活，那还蛮多也有是工作需求的，他可能刚好是个法务，他希望可以用 AI 把一些资料透过就是 AI 机器人然后更好的让大家找到这样子。 OK， 好，然后哦，刚刚那边还有一个重要是，随着 AI 的发展，今年的 AI、应用专案也提升了，这样。那这边是以专案孵化竞赛来说，今年的参与状况。首先那个我们会发现就是在2020年的时候学生提案数其实比较少，到2023年已经开始提升了。那我们也有发现虽然学生的提案变多了，但是其实学生专案的永续性是比较低的，因为大家也知道一个是他们很多课业，他们人生有很多选择，然后以及社会或家庭的支持会影响他们做专案的动机。OK， 好，那再来我们也想聊一下，我们曾经对所有来参加过临时小学校专案的人做过影响力问卷，我们问他说你觉得来 GLINV 专提案的理由会是什么。比较多人认为说在 GLINV 提案他可以有一个贡献社会跟自我价值的实现，那再来其次是他觉得他个人能力有提升，然后再来一个是他觉得说我开始有更多人协作的经验，包含跟不同年龄的然后不同领域的人，然后最后就是他们觉得可能对他的生涯或升学有帮助。好，那最后一个小小的 ending 是想跟大家分享，我们在这四年以及我们访问了就是参与那个非心理 Ocean 一个国际的黑客松的学生们，然后我们在访谈之后发现到底青年他们会需要什么样的协助。第一个是他们会很希望我做一个公民科技经验可以帮助我升学或是有更多的就业机会，所以我们会建议第一个是各国可能都有一些学生开始在做公民科技的专案，包含像最近大家应该有听到地震速报 APP， 它其实也是学生在做公民科技的专案。那如果我们可以把这些经验记录下来，然后它可以让其他学生借鉴，甚至可以让其他企业看到说这样的经验其实有其他企业是愿意采纳，而且他们看到它的能力。那另一个就是他们会希望有没有可能对让整个社会让更多公司可以认同公民科技的经验，然后另外一个就是有没有可能帮我们创造一些就是跟业界的连结，包含像实习，有没有可能像专案孵化竞赛我不只提供奖金，我甚至提供实习的机会这样。那第二点就是降低原有公民科技的参与门槛，那这件事情就是刚刚小学校我们有试了很多方法，那在学生访谈下我们有获得的一些建议是学生他们其实很需要技术的资源，不论是像 Figma 或是 Notion 等等的给予就是免费使用的一些机会，他们可以接触到更多不同的数位工具。那另外一个就是学生其实非常忙，你要在他课余时间让他来做专案或者是让他来上课，其实对他们来讲需要很多的抉择，因为大家知道疫情之后有超多的课程跟活动可以选择，很多学生一次就报了五个活动，然后当天再决定我这五个活动我要参加哪一个，所以就是 commitment 有点低。那会比较建议就是我们干脆跟现有的体制合作，跟学校合作，然后让他本来在他的就是上课时间就可以来接触到那个公民科技。那另外一个我觉得这个很有趣，这是一个韩国学生回馈的，他说在韩国有好多学生都会参加竞赛，但是很多评审都不懂公民科技的意义，然后他说有没有可能多办一些更符合公民科技理念的竞赛，让他们可以来参与，然后也让他们有更多获奖的机会跟资源。 OK， 那这以上是我们小学校跟 FTO 的学生们给的一个建议，然后提供大家参考。那最后就是小学校其实想做的事情是我们不想只开一堂课，我们希望创造一个永续的数位公民教育循环，让他可以在学习之后学以致用，然后真的做了专案之后再回来开源经验。那数位公民素养其实不只有专案协作这样的能力，那我们最近这几年有开始跟不同的单位像放办教育协会等等，我们一起在讨论说到底数位公民素养还包含了哪一些内容。那如果有兴趣的话，我们这边有开始整理了第一份对外公开，这是应该是首度对外公开，大家可以扫一下。那这个等一下我会在我们对谈的时候再多补充一些，就是我们会认为说数位公民素养它应该会有一个通则，那这些通则应该可以在不同的领域都用到这样子，那也希望有更多人跟我们一起来推动数位公民教育。 OK， 好，那小学校分享到这边，感谢大家。 OK， 好，那下一个我们会邀请桑雅上来分享来自 Call for Germany 还有很多不同德国经验。那 OK， Let's welcome 桑雅。
你好。
I'm Sonia,
and here come my slides.
Hello, thank you very much for inviting me today. Also, thank you to the kind interpreters. I will do my best to speak somewhat slowly. It is not easy for me, but really happy to be here. I represent my organization, the Open Knowledge Foundation Germany, and one of our programs is Code for Germany, a network of volunteers. And also, because this is about youth-led innovation, I will present to you one of our other programs that's called Jugendhackt, that's German for youth hacks. But, nope, this is down. There we go. First, I will tell you a little bit about the historical context of civic tech activities in Germany. So, about now 40 years ago, in the 1980s, one of the first civic organizations that was interested in hacking for social good, bringing social values and technology together, was the so-called Chaos Computer Club in Germany. And that later, 20 years later, brought forth, or was at least the ground upon which an open data movement could take a hold in Germany. Open data movement, like all German civic tech activities, they have a strong political motive. In general, Germany now is a very safe country for its citizens, not for everyone, of course. We heard in the opening keynote that Germany also has very like right-wing extremist parties. The AfD was mentioned with their Nazi hate speech. And that is something that we, in the digital civil society now, really want to fight against. So all of our activities in Germany are highly political in that we strive for more transparency and higher accountability of the government. And also we want to somewhat force the government or encourage the government to be more open to civic engagement, to produce more open source tools, to make their data available, and all that good stuff that makes digital citizenship possible. Well, but what does the German government do in terms of digital citizenship education and in terms of collaboration with civil actors? Oh, is it not loading? You know, Germany once was really known and renowned for being forward in technology, you know, Siemens and building the cars and all of that. And in some ways, Germany really is a very forward country. I myself come from Austria, close to Germany, but not the same. And I'm really happy to live in Germany. But some things are more difficult for German authorities, for the German government, than you would think. For example, German authority, German government, has a lot of bureaucracy. And many things you'd expect to be able to do online as a citizen, you still have to go to the office and try and get an appointment. And some things are even still done by fax machine, still used in the government. And we as civil society, we really try and encourage the German government to be more open to collaboration. They are somewhat getting around to it, but there's still some work to do. And that is some of the work that we do in my organization. Together with about 40 colleagues, we are the team of the Open Knowledge Foundation Germany.
We were founded in 2011, so we're over 10 years old now, and we have several programs. You can see those programs on the screen. The two highlighted ones I will tell you a little bit more about. Code for Germany, I will go into this in a second. We have the next one, Frag den Staat, that is German for Ask the State. This is a platform where you as a citizen can really, in an easy way, make use of your right of information. The German law makes it so that you as a citizen can inquire, hey, what is the local city that I live in spending its money on? Or can I have a look at this and that contract that the government signed with a private company? And it's not always that easy, you know, because of German bureaucracy. And so some of my colleagues built a platform, a digital platform, that makes it way easier. And on top of that, they do political campaigns to encourage more people to be aware of these things. We also have the aforementioned Jugendhackt, German for youth hacks. I'll also go into this in a bit more detail. Then we have two projects concerned with open source and open hardware. The Prototype Fund is a program that we have that gets money from the Ministry of Education and Research and acts as a middle person to give out grants to people who have who build prototypes that are open source and contribute to society. And we also launched the Open Hardware Fund that does the same for not only like software but hardware projects. These are my fellow Code for Germany people. This picture was taken a couple of years ago at one of our annual summits, where the volunteers from the Code for Germany network meet annually. And something that's really interesting to me, whenever I go to international conferences or when I talk to colleagues or people who do similar things that I do abroad, volunteering in Germany has a very strong recognition in society. It is very honored and very seen as a good thing to give your time to do volunteering, and your employers will also sometimes give you time off to do volunteering. That makes it possible for us to have a very, very strong volunteer network. And we as the Open Knowledge Foundation and me personally, we are here to provide the infrastructure that these volunteers need to do stuff in their free time. But basically, they run the shop, they do what they want because they know best, they are the experts, and we, the employees, are just here to give them infrastructure with our online community, with the servers that they need, etc. Let me check the time. There we go. Those are some screenshots from the website of Code for Germany, code4.de. You will find this map where we have regional groups, regional labs, where the volunteers meet. And they are as diverse as the projects that the volunteers do. Some meet in their local city hall, some meet in a cafe, some meet in a hackerspace. Some of the project examples that our volunteers create include the one on the bottom left, that is about government spending. That makes it transparent through open data that the government provides what the government spends its money on. That's really important for accountability and holding the government responsible to what they do, so that we can see when they promise something, are they actually delivering it? And the one above it, top left, that tells you for the little town in northwest Germany called Moers, that tells you when your next spot in the waiting line for City Hall will open up. Because, as I mentioned, you still have to go to the City Hall very often with German bureaucracy. So one of our volunteers, he built a little online platform for that. Oh, top right, that is more than Germany. This is all of Europe that you can see here. This is from our sensor community. That was a project that started with Code for Germany in the town of Stuttgart, but that got so popular that is now expanding to a worldwide, or at least Europe-wide community. They built little, very low-cost, do-it-yourself sensors and published the information on how to build those sensors on their website, and you can like get those kits from them. And then you can build a little sensor and put it up somewhere in your city and measure, for example, the air quality in your city. Because in some German cities, the air quality is much better than others. And if it's really bad, you can go and tell your government, hey, why don't you make it more expensive for cars to have a really bad exhaustion that produces a lot of CO2. This is our youth project, Jugendhackt, German for youth hacks. And that is a program for young people between the age of 12 and 18 years old who want to improve the world with their technical skills. And that happens in different formats. My colleagues who work at Jugendhackt, they host hackathon events all over Germany, also really helped by volunteers, a huge volunteer community who act as mentors for the young people. And like with GovZero, that TIFF presented, your programs, many of the people who were participants first later become mentors. And because the hackathons happen in big cities, we also host local workshops in makerspaces, in libraries, in like youth centers, in smaller villages and towns in Germany. There is also an online community and some conferences and exchanges. And the picture that you see here was taken in 2018, I believe, when Jugendhackt had an exchange with South Korea and Japan. And I myself was fortunate enough to be at such an exchange program in 2019 in Tokyo, and that was really inspiring to see how young people from different countries come together and bring their different ideas with their different backgrounds into the project ideas. Because very similar to what TIFF told us about the project ideas that your students have here, our students in Germany, they also make and create projects mostly concerning their everyday reality. A lot of our projects center around how to improve the schools, but also other societal issues like how to combat climate change, and also sometimes how to better engage fellow young people in political activities and make them more aware of what is going on in the current government. And that's it. Thank you very much. Those are my two cats. Thank you very much.
The question, what's the cat's name?
The question was, what are the cat's names? The smaller one is Saffron, and the bigger one's her sister, Cornflake.
Thank you, Saya and her cats. Okay.
那接下来我们会欢迎那个来自日本的 Coffer Japan 的 Saya 分享。OK, it's your turn, Saya.
Hello, everyone. Hi. Oh, I was sitting in front, so I didn't expect this many people actually joining. Thank you so much for coming.Okay, so in this part, I will introduce about my organization, Coffer Japan, and since this theme is about digital citizenship, so I will introduce some activities related to the digital citizenship. And when I speak in English, I normally speak so fast, so I will try as slow as possible, and sorry for interpretation if I speak too fast, but I will try my best. Okay. So, at the okay, first of all, about myself. So I'm international coordinator for Coffer Japan. So I normally coordinate some exchange or international program for students. And when I was university student, I studied abroad in Norway for 1 year to study about inclusive education. So I actually went to like local Norwegian junior high school. So, and I was so impressed by how their ICT education is developed.And after that, I worked, so before Coffer Japan, I worked at IT and welfare company. So I taught programming to kids who have learning disabilities. And as you can see this photo, I have also two dogs. And I love, you know, they don't like being photographed, so they look like, oh, God, please let me go home. But, you know, I love it. You know, we love each other, so. Okay. No. Okay. So first of all, about Coffer Japan.So we are one of the largest civic tech community in Japan, and we have around 20 members, and half of them are full-time and half of them are part-time. And I think Hao-san, our founder, is now having the session in different room, but Hao-san started Coffer Japan in 2013. And I think it's really interesting to explain how civic tech become popular in Japan. So like history of civic tech in Japan.So in Japan, because we have so many natural disasters, like earthquake or something, so in 2011, we had the Great East Japan earthquake happen. And after the earthquake happened, like within like 3 hours, this Shinsai.info is a website about the old information about earthquake gathered. And this website happened, and around 300 contributors gathered online, and they created.And Hao-san, our founder, is also one of the core members of Shinsai.info. So after the earthquake, he wanted to continue this kind of civic tech project. And then he searched about civic tech, and he found out there's an organization called Coffer America in US. So he actually went to US and visited Coffer America and asked, can we have it in Japan as well? And then he started Coffer Japan from 2013.And one of the significant change for Coffer Japan is after COVID happened. So during the COVID, we conducted Tokyo Metropolitan Government COVID website. And since we did it with the open source, so around 300 contributors also gathered, and we created this website. So the Coffer Japan become more popular. So, and before the COVID, we have around 700 members on our Slack community, but right now we have more than 8,000 members.And one of the characteristics about Coffer Japan is we have a local community called Brigade. And we have around 80 brigades all over Japan. So almost all prefectures have at least one civic tech local community. And Coffer Japan has three main areas of activity. One is community and GovTech and Maker City, which is a smart city area.And since community sector has more activities related to digital citizenship, so I will talk about more detail about community sector. So first of all, we have digital citizenship workshop. And so far we have done 3 times of workshop at high school. And first one is in Hyogo Prefecture, and next one is in Shizuoka Prefecture, and last one is in Hokkaido.My first one, Hyogo Prefecture, was Kakogawa East High School. And Kakogawa City is one of the first cities which used DECIDEM in Japan. So Kofu Japan had conducted the Japanese version of Desiden for the first time, and Kakogawa City tried the very first time. So we have some connection, and Kakogawa West and East High School has some special STEM education subject. So in this subject, we did this workshop for, it was 2 days workshop. So first day we had some lecture about how to find social issues. And one of our, some designers from Kofu Japan told how to use Figma to create some mock-up. And then last day, we had the student had to present what they created and also had to show about some their prototype with Figma. And Shizuoka and Hokkaido also kind of same, but it was only 2 or 3 days a workshop. So for more deeper and longer approach, we have Civic Tech Challenge Cup under 22. It is a student prototype contest for 3 months. And this contest actually started from one of the student interns for Kofu Japan came up with this idea. So it was during the COVID situation because most of the students didn't have any opportunity for internship or extracurricular activities. So instead of just staying at home, he wanted to do some opportunity to give some opportunity for students. So mostly the student need to find some social issues and create some prototype, and it will connect to the career development. These are the 4 years result. So we started from 2020, and last year we also had it. And in total, we have more than 500 students participated in this contest. And every year we have workshops, and those workshops, some are conducted by student intern, but mostly we invited some guests from outside. And I think this is one of the biggest difference from Gabzel or Kofu Germany, but we have personal private company sponsors, and they became the mentors for students, not like OG or OB from CCC. So, for example, AWS gave us some lectures for hands-on, Salesforce or other companies. The people from those companies became mentors for students, and Figma also gave us some Figma, they let us use for the Figma education for free. So this is our schedule for last year. So we started in July, and then we have midterm report in September, and we have final in October. And last year we had the CCC finalists went to the Gabzel Schools that won last demo day. So, and then I will explain more about it later. So for the last year's new challenge for 2023 is because it was CCC started during the COVID, so it was completely online for the last 3 years. But last year, because the situation of COVID is the restriction was not that really hard, so we started to have some in-person event for the first time. So we had Ideathon, and also last final in Tokyo was also in person. So we invited the finalists to Tokyo, and we support the transportation fee. And also we gave some engineer and designer assignment because the last 3 years, one of the biggest challenge for the event was because it was completely online, so it was hard to keep the motivation up for the students. So we gave some assignment and the student need to choose at least one engineer or designer. And after they pass it, they could continue their next step. So by doing this, giving the assignment, the student gets some at least like minimum knowledge about engineer or designer. So they have high motivation and it actually success, then there's not that many people to drop off before the final. And this is a winning team from last year called Bear Tech. So since it was online, so some students from abroad also joined. And actually this team are 3 members from Brown University in US. They're Japanese students, but they study abroad in US. And they created this voice editing service for people with stuttering. And one of the members' brother has stutter, so, and then he knew that he had some problem for having job interview. So he wanted to help, so they created this website. And we need to upload our voice, and they created the voice without a stutter. And also, the good point of this website is they use our own voice. So I think some services has like, you know, we can create some AI voice without stutter, but this service is we can use our voice. And also they give some good feedbacks, only good feedback they give us. And this is the one I explained, I mentioned before. So last year we had exchange program for CCC and Skuza one. And last March, we brought 10 students from Japan. And because there is a Skuza one demo day and Johnson Hackathon event, so we joined and CCC students gave their exhibition presentation in English. So these are some schedules. So first day, we visited Impact Hub, which Gabza Johnson office is located. So the staff from Impact Hub gave us some tours, so we got to know what kind of organization you have in Taipei. And next day, there is a Skuza One demo day, so the students from Japan also presented in English. And Johnson gave us some tours, so we also got to know what kind of project you have. And also we had after party, so students got dinner together. Last day, we had Taipei City Tour by Gabza members, and we also had farewell lunch. Okay. And for the next challenge, we have Facing the Ocean event in Japan. And this is joint Japan and Taiwan and Korea hackathon event. This year it's going to be 2 days, but it is like non-competition hackathon event, so it's really, really fun. So I really hope everyone can join it. And if you have any question, you can always ask us. And it's going to be like 1 day, anyone can join, and if you are interested in civic tech or if you have any project, you can also bring it. And if you don't have any project, that's also okay, so you can join any project if you want. So yeah, please join us. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Saya. 等一下我们的那个环节会进行那个对谈，然后我们有准备了一些题目。那如果说大家立刻有想到一些题目想要跟我们聊一聊的话，也可以赶快扫 slide 让我们知道，然后我们会抓紧时间好好的跟大家把想问的问题聊完这样。那Saya, OK. Let's sit here together.Okay.
Thank you so much.
OK， 我们等一下第一个问题啊，就是我们想要跟大家聊一下，因为刚刚其实比较多是各国在分享我们怎么样去推动数位公民教育。那到底我们自己对于数位公民教育的想象是什么？我们想要趁这个对谈来聊一下。OK， so this is the first question that I know you all have already prepared for that. So yeah, and it will goes from Saya. OK.
So for that definition, I want to first introduce about what Japanese government used the definition. So for the Japanese government, it said digital citizenship education is education designed to help young people develop the competencies they need to be effective digital citizens. And I wanted to add, it's not only for young people, but also like everyone, for adult as well, becauseYou know, I even didn't learn how to use digital at school, but we are the one who need to teach the digital students of education to the kids. So I think we also need to, you know, update our ideas. And also for the, this is the one of the website from Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications. So this website is, there is a 4 categories for,preschooler and other 18 years old student, and also for the parents and teachers and senior. So I think it's really important to have some, like each categories have, you know, different approach. So I think it's really good things to have, you know, it's not only for one target, but we have like separate target.
So the definition of digital citizenship education for Germany is, well, I've tried to find a official definition that the government issues, but I didn't find one. Maybe it was hidden in layers of German bureaucracy. And so I would like to give the definition that we have from a civil society perspective. So the definition would be that digital citizenship education is the empowerment of young people or citizens of any age to be able to make use of their rights as citizens and to have, you know, to have the tools available for them, to have the knowledge, and also someone have the agency to speak up or to concern themselves with the political goings-on, to interact with that. And the German school system does not provide that. There is teaching for like IT skills and how to use devices, how to use the internet to some extent. But German schools are notoriously underfunded. The German curriculum in the country is very different depending on the region you go to. Germany is a very federated country. That means every like county, for example, Bavaria is very different from Berlin or the area where the city of Hamburg is. So they will have different curriculums. Students will learn different things in school. So that's why we think that extracurricular afternoon activities like youth hacks are really important, because that's a place where we as civil society actors can teach them about technical skills, but also teach them about social values, and not just for career purposes, not just for like individual gain, but to use that for like the betterment of society as a whole.
And 好，那其实我刚刚在分享的时候已经有提到说，台湾目前的那个数位公民的素养定义其实蛮分散的。那我举个例好，就是之前那个沙雅有邀请我说，日本有一个资讯协会想来台湾参访资讯教育。那我发现他们其实想要的资讯教育好像不是那么单纯，单纯好像就是教技术使用，然后以及我个人的对数位公民素养的想象会比较偏向它应该是可以更跨领域的，然后更以学习者为主体的。所以我那时候也找了很多不同的学校单位，最后就有找到像在宜兰中山国小林颖俊老师的课，他是希望可以运用数位工具去协助孩子不同的那个自主学习的课程，然后也在不同的课里面去结合数位工具。那我们那个小学校其实刚刚有提到，我们其实有开始以公民自己实际亲身实践跟研究的经验去谈说，到底除了专案协作 Julian V 做的这些之外，我们是不是有漏掉一些我们每个公民应该都要具备的。那首先就是我们有跟放办教育协会合作，大家知道他们一直长期有在关注媒体素养的那个就是假讯息、资讯判读这些的议题。然后我们发现就是其实在我们把它分了几个层次，一个是个人的层次。那在个人的部分呢，我们其实刚开始比较多是孩子或是一个学习者或是任何的公民，他在接触到网络的时候，他需要去理解这个资讯他的就是不论是好坏是不是假的，然后对我没有用，所以他会先进行资讯判别的状况的阶段。然后再来就是我们其实也一直在关注到底要怎么样去谈治安、数位人权等等的议题。好，那在个人层次就是你开始禁用，你接触到这些网络资讯之后，会进入到分析的阶段，你怎么样去更好的用批判思考的能力去了解这个资讯对你来说，第一是先判断它是不是假讯息，第二是这资讯对你来讲有没有用，然后会再来就是它够不够客观等等的。然后再来个人层次到分析结束之后，我们 会进到群体的部分。那群体我们放了两个重点，一个是沟通协作，因为你其实在接触网络，你一定会进入到社群，然后尤其现在大家社群媒体使用的很频繁，所以你会开始跟很多人在数位进行沟通。但数位沟通的时候其实需要很多的妹妹嘎嘎，然后你连以及现在其实还蛮多孩子会受到数位诈骗的问题，那大家怎么样去辨识那个人，然后以及怎么样做好的沟通，怎么样用好的数位工具跟人家协作，会在这个阶段发生。那再来就是他开始参与不同的社群进行协作之后，他也许会开始观察到一些问题，那他有没有办法进入到创造阶段去觉察分析问题，然后甚至去提出数位解方，然后在这过程中开始去练习团队合作，然后去落实开源，然后去认识更多新的那个科技资讯。那最后一个我们觉得比较大一点的就是我们有看到现在学生专案开始有在解决不同的问题，但是要到真的去影响整个社会层次，可能还是像要到 G0V 就是社群这样的一个层级，像包含像 COFAX 真的假的这样的专案，其实已经不仅影响台湾，也影响到泰国，有更多不同的专案，然后去影响整个国家假讯息的一些发展的现况。所以到最后我们会希望它是一个进程，就是它从个人开始能够去做资讯判读，然后能够去批判思考，再来去做公共协作，然后去创造一个专案，去体验一个解决社会问题的过程，然后最后它可以意识到它有一个社会的责任，然后去做出更多的社会的行动这样子。所以这是我们目前对数位公民素养的一些定义跟内涵。那如果大家对这个有一些其他想法的话，欢迎下午来参加我们的世界咖啡馆，我们会跟大家有更多的讨论。 OK， 好，那下一个问题我们想要来聊的就是因为我们三个其实都是从公民科技社群去推动数位公民教育，那到底这样子的一个角色他去推动的机会跟挑战是什么，然后聊好，然后我们需要哪一些的支持。 OK， 那一样我们会先从Saya开始。
Okay, so for that, I think I wanted to focus on challenges. So I think especially in Japan, it's really important to focus on the digital inclusive if you want to promote the digital citizenship education. So because I want to focus on three parts. So one is because in Japan we call like super aging society. So almost like 30% of population gonna be like more than 65 years old people. And normally those people, you know, if you know people that those generations are left behind. So it's important to include include them as well. And also the next one, people who have learning some disability. Because I teach at my previous job, I taught programming to kids who have learning disabilities. And I think like those ICT education, because there's especially like programming or like some designer thing, there's not one correct answer. So everyone can be correct. And I think it's really important to have, you know, because there's no wrong answer. So it's easy to get some self-confidence as well. So, and also those education can expand their possibilities. So it's also important to include those people as well. And lastly, the private company, because if you want to deal with some like online disinformation or slander problem, it's normally we cannot solve with education, because the people who do this kind of thing is like our age, our generation. So, and if we cooperate with some private company, because they have those kind of platform, so it's important to also collaborate with the private company as well, private sector as well. I think that's all.
Thank you. So, in the German context, the challenges that we have with like digital citizenship education is first challenge is pronouncing, and especially when it comes to young people. So I told you that this kind of education is not included in the official curriculum that students get in school. So these programs are held elsewhere, sometimes from private companies, organizations, but they will have a specific interest either in promoting their product or getting people to join their company, normal. But then there as I said, Germany relies on a very, very strong civil society to push for values, to push the already functioning democracy, like functioning democracy in Germany, but to make it better, to improve it, to help it not to slip away and turn into something like far right and bad. So the civil society needs support by continuous funding from the government. And this kind of activity, using your tech skills for social good, I think it could also use a little more recognition in overall society. So lobbying, political like decisions, policies towards making that more accessible would be interesting. And also, one thing, like in many parts of society, like in many parts of life, we have a bit of a bias in our youth hacking programs. These programs notoriously attract more young males than females or other genders. And so we are really trying to do our best to, for example, host events that are specific to people who are not cis male. And we do that by also encouraging more mentors of different genders and with different skill sets to be role models for the participants.
Thank you. 我想要来分享一下，就是林小学校这样推动四年，刚机会其实大家应该都看到，就是 Julie V 有很多不同的大神，然后很多的资源，但我觉得我们遇到的挑战是，很多学校老师会认为说 Julie V 在做的专案太难了，孩子要做到这个层级不可能，所以他们会仰望，但觉得难以实践。然后，但是如果我们今天要进去学校去跟他们谈，像我们认为说 PBL Project Based Learning 这样子的一个学习概念，其实就是我们在做专案的一个概念。但他们会觉得我们在教育上不够专业，所以我们会小学校卡在一个中间的状态，就是老师们一个是觉得哦，也许他们早就已经有自己 PBL 的方法，然后但是然后也会觉得说他们真的要学生做到 Julie V 专案这样层次又有点困难，所以这是我们目前面临的挑战，但也很开心我们一直都有找到很多像善于教 PBL 然后也同时有在参加社群的老师一起来想要怎么样把这样的角色做得更好这样。然后另外一个是我们其实如果以一个那个学习的网络来看，其实刚刚那个松雅也有提到不同的角色，他其实有很多可以给予支持的部分。那我这边都先针对是那个比较偏学习就是学校教育这个阶段的一个建议。但我觉得我也很佩服刚刚Saya他其实有提到说，社会公民教育它不是只有给学生的，它应该是每个年龄层的公民都需要的这样。那在那个这个学习网络里面，在社会层次的话，其实除了我们这些公民科技社群或非营利组织一直在推动之外，我们其实也很需要不同的企业，它去像刚刚讲提供更多的知识、技术、资金或工作的实习机会，然后以及去提升对公民科技经验的认同。那再来是政府单位，就是我们很开心它开始有重视了，但我觉得像台湾书发部跟教育部其实它是两个部门，他们会各自开始在做一些不同的科技教育的事情，但也许跟学校的老师一样，他们需要更多的是跨领域的合作，所以也许他们在制定的时候可以有更多的协作讨论。那另外就是其实在108课刚刚已经有开放像自主学习课、探究与实作课、多元选修课，让更多外界的单位可以进来学校开课，让学生有更多的学习资源。但是我们希望这些资源也许并不是每个学校他们知道说有这些管道，但他们没找不到资源，所以其实是对应不起来的。那政府有没有办法有开更多的建议，像可能有个清单，有哪一些单位目前正有好的就是教案或是教学资源可以进校，然后去协助你开多元课。那再来就是家庭这边有家长吗？可能有一些，有一些没有，就是 我之前有听到一些孩子会反映说，爸妈可能不太理解他到底为什么要花这么多时间在 Julie V， 然后在那边做专案，这对你的升学有帮助吗？然后就会阻挡他做专案。但是、有一些人看起来一直在点头，有一些学生在点头。然后其实我自己在看，因为 Julie V 已经十二年了嘛，所以很多像村长他们其实都有自己的孩子了。然后以及我自己在。以前在学校我们就会鼓励家长，你今天其实你要去以身作则去追寻的梦想，孩子是会看着你的路径成长，而且你去追寻的梦想就不会一直关注孩子到底在干嘛，自己有事情做，有找到重心，就不会一直看着孩子了。然后另一个就是就是多鼓励孩子去参与，那你如果还没有办法理解到底参与这个可以获得什么的话，可以去就 Julie V 有好多孩子的故事，我们都有放在小学校网站，可以去看看那些故事，或者是学生们、同学们，你可以拿给你的家长。然后最后就是学校的话，如果是决策者层次的话，其实会更希望可以，因为现在其实学校有校定课程，然后或者是决策者他可以决定我要跟哪一个单位长期合作，所以会很希望就像校长这样层级或教育那个教务主任等等的，他们可以鼓励学校的老师做这件事情。那教师自己，我们其实这几年办了一些师培，但发现老师们参与度并没有那么高，某部分是因为老师其实也很忙，我们可以理解。然后另外一个就是做专案这件事本身就对他们来讲蛮恐怖的，因为你要面对学生可能同时有五个不同的领域，然后每个来问你的时候就要想说，哦，我天哪，我也不是资讯领域，或是我不是了解居住正义的，我要怎么回答他这样，然后就会瑟瑟发抖。但就是所以我们其实就想告诉老师说 Julie V 能够协助你，这里有资源，所以欢迎你来进修。然后进修的其实只是要告诉你怎么样带领专案，而不是你要了解每一个领域，像一个百科全书一样。所以我们在教的是老师怎么样成为一个教练引导者的角色。然后另外就是虽然现在有一些自主学习课，然后或是多元选修课，但它会变成学生准备考试的时候，那老师有没有办法去鼓励学生正在这个时候去发展自主学习，做一个专案，其实角色蛮重要。然后学生自己有没有办法去好好争取，也是一个我觉得很重要的关键这样。好，那最后一题的话呢，就是我们想要聊一下是如果我们获得了上述全面的支持的话，我们觉得还可以再做些什么。 OK， 那等一下我们一样从赛亚先。
So for me, I would like to promote the more exchange program for students. Yeah, like this. Last year we had FDO in Jeju-eolan, and we had some Korean and Taiwan and Japanese students. And last March, I mentioned before, but we had like CCC and Schools That Want exchange program. And it was actually really successful. And when I organized this event first, like the CCC and Schools That Want project, first I wanted to, of course, them to have experience like have.Successful experience buying, like being understood in English, but also at the same time, I also wanted them to experience some, you know, frustration by not being understood in English, because those feeling can be motivating to study English and also, you know, to more have communication with other people who have different background or different language, and also through exchanging this, you know, opinion or.Some project, I think we can get some new perspective, and it's really important to have, you know, different perspective and also expand their, you know, options as well. And also, it's my personal experience, but for me also, when I first studied abroad, it was in New Zealand, and when I was 14 years old, and I couldn't speak English at all. But, you know, those people who live in New Zealand, they're so kind, but they talk to me a lot, but I didn't understand.Anything. So I felt so stressed about myself, and that makes me study English a lot. And now, since study abroad in Norway and other countries, then my perspective, you know, expands so much. So I really wanted to have those kind of experience for students as well, and also for the to promote this studentship education. I think it's really important to have money and also the sense of belonging, because those are the two big motivation for the people to continue some projects. So I know it's really hard to keep the make the people who the feel, you know, I'm belonging here. And also it's because for organizing CCC, it was also really difficult part to feel the student, the belonging there, and also have high motivation to continue. So I think it's also, yeah, if I have some opportunity or enough skill, I really wanted to promote those two things.
Thank you. Really well said. It is hard for me to add anything. So, yeah, this sense of belonging, creating a community that will last even if individual people go away, that I think is something really valuable for people of any age, but I think especially for young people who have many other things to do besides like volunteer or extracurricular engagement, I think it's really important to provide a structure where they know, okay, I can come today, but maybe I don't come next week, maybe I don't come next month, but it will be still there when I want to join again. So also creating a safe space, like we have here with the code of conduct and with the shared values, so that everyone can feel welcome. And also, something that was really well said by you, exchange. I think it's really easy for people to get sort of like lost in their daily problems. And it's really important to look at those because that's what you know best. But sometimes it helps to look really outside of the box and see how it's done in other countries, in other contexts, with people from different backgrounds, even in your own country. So I think if our organization had more money and support, we would try to reach also young people who we don't reach yet, because they think that this is not for them. Maybe they think that I don't know enough, I can't code, they think this is too elite. Yeah? So making programs more accessible, fostering exchange, and then creating a safe space. Those are the things.
Okay. 我想其实刚刚要讲的都差不多，就是大家应该会注意到我们现在临时小学校专注的学生群其实是本身学习动机比较高的，所以很多演讲我们常常收到的回馈是，你们有没有到乡村地区或是弱势族群的孩子上做一些数位公民教育的推广。其实因为我自己是教育工作者，我知道这个很重要，但我们也发现其实动机的问题，目前在 GLV 社群的经验下，我们不一定目前还不到有心力解决，但我们一直很重视。所以如果有更多的资源，我们还蛮想要去尝试去开发另一套课程，去鼓励这些低动机的孩子。然后另外一个是，我觉得 Saya 今天很棒，有提到说数位公民教育不是只有孩子们需要，那其他年龄层到底怎么做。然后我们那天有一个蛮好的讨论，就是其实公民科技社群本身的存在就是 for 青年的一种数位公民教育了，只是现在我们各个教育专案是往18岁以下在做。那到底我们说大龄国民好了，45岁以上或是50岁以上的这群人，我们现在要怎么样让他们更能够感受到融入在这个数位的社会里面，而不是被数位排挤？我觉得这也是我觉得我们可以再多做的。对，然后因为时间的关系呢，我们来 show 一下 slide， 可能可以聊个一个问题。小。OK， 好 ，OK， 第一个问题 ，OK， 哦 ，Sarah and Stone，You can see this first question， 我用中文解释一下，就是台湾跟德国，就是我们怎么样获得我们的那个 funding 赞助，然后他们也想问 Sarah 说，你觉得有没有就是 there will be any 有没有一些期待是来自于赞助者？他们会不会希望你们做些什么这样子 ？OK， maybe go from Sonia.
Yeah, you can just.
So the funding for our civic tech activities in Germany, they come from some government funding.When we apply for certain like grants that the government hands out, some of the money comes from
private donors, for example, the program about freedom of information, the platform Ask the State, they raise with their political campaigns, they raise a lot of donations from people who feel like they can give something. And sometimes for our youth hacking programs, we do take sponsorship money, but we make it very clear to the sponsors that they are not allowed to interfere in the program, but they can have their logo so that the people know they're doing something good. And maybe they get photos from the event. So the funding comes from government money of Germany. Sometimes it's private foundations that have money for a good cause, that give grants, private donations, and sometimes very small part sponsorships for events.
So for the Code for Japan, I didn't mention about what kind of GovTech area we have, but mainly our main money resources from GovTech area. And so for the for example, CCC, we do have strong expectation from sponsors. Like they want to, of course, promote their company. And also what kind of, so after finish CCC, the student, what kind of career path or what kind of activity they still continue. So you have to report what they do, or, and also some of the finalist team, we one of the team members got they started the company of their project. So I think that was really, really good result for the sponsors. Yeah, for the sponsors.
那快速讲一下小学校的，因为小学校专案是在救松团里面的一个专案，所以我们所有的赞助都来自于各位公民们的定期定额赞助。然后我们现在也很努力在推广，希望大家定期定额。喂，好。然后另外一个就是我们会有一些个人的大笔的赞助，以及一些企业赞助，但是就是不一定那么稳定，所以就是这也是小学校每一年的那个状况都会有一些变化的原因。然后因为时间的关系，接下来这几个问题，我们下午呢，好，让我
because the time we have to be the closing, so.
好，我先回到我们的 slides。 好，那我们下午的时候有一场那个世界咖啡馆，然后其实我们想做的就是今天大家都在听我们讲，但我们其实更想听不同背景的公民大家的经验是什么，所以我们预计会探讨这四题。那我们也会安排同步口译，然后时间是在今天下午2:10到5:20，在四楼的交易厅。然后如果你就是觉得时间有限，你也可以选择参加上半场或下半场就好，就是它是一个 free talk。然后另外一个就是因为我们今天的活动是 FNF 的伙伴有就是跟我们合作，然后我们也很希望可以了解大家今天参与完之后对于税公民教育的一些理解跟想法，所以想麻烦大家帮我扫一下那个活动问卷。那the first one is for English survey, and 如果是台下感觉都是台湾人，可以帮我小中文的。对，然后刚刚的问题呢，就是大家可以等一下吃中餐的时候可以去找沙雅跟松雅聊聊，然后亦或是在下午世界咖啡馆跟我们一起聊。 OK, 好，那我们留一点时间给大家。好，感谢大家今天就是一起来跟我们聊聊数位公民教育，那期待我们可以在下午的时候见到你们。好，谢谢大家。